Throughout history, there have been many famous bombers. Planes like the Boeing B-17 Flying Fortress. This legendary 4-engine heavy bomber bore the brunt of the U.S. strategic bombing campaign against Germany in World War II. Its incredible ruggedness made it one of the most beloved planes by its crews of all time. The de Havilland Mosquito. This amazingly versatile light bomber could carry the bomb load of a flying fortress, yet had the speed of a fighter. Conceptually ahead of its time, it was the forerunner of the modern light attack bomber. The B-29 Superfortress. With more range, speed, and payload than any of its contemporaries, this remarkable aircraft was quite simply the best heavy bomber of World War II. The giant B-52 Stratofortress. This 8-engine behemoth was introduced in the 1950s and has seen longer continuous frontline service than any bomber ever made. All these aircraft were, from the outside, very different. Yet they were all joined by a common thread. That thread is the men who flew them. No matter what its design capabilities, every bomber requires a brave and skillful crew to achieve its maximum effectiveness. These are the stories of those extraordinary crews and the missions they flew.
A bomber, from the outside, appears to be just a very large aircraft, headed with others exactly like it to carry out a mission, to deliver high explosives to targets deep in enemy territory. But in reality, this weapon is a highly complex blend of man and machine. Vast distances, uncertain weather, and enemy defenses are some of the many external obstacles these great aircraft face. But a successful mission requires superior equipment, rigorous training, and above all, teamwork. Every member of the crew performing his job perfectly, every time. Survival itself depends on each crew member's dedication and professionalism. One man's failure could mean the end for all. The pilot keeps the plane in the air. The navigator finds the target area. The bombardier finds the target and releases the bombs, while the gunners keep the enemy fighters away. And for as long as the mission takes, the crew must blend their special talents and training into a solid, cohesive unit. What must it be like to be up there riding one of these great planes into the chaos of battle? Let's find out from the men who've been there, the men who flew the bombers.
The B-17 Flying Fortress.
You're looking at a formation of B-17 Flying Fortresses, part of the 91st Heavy Bombardment Group of the United States 8th Air Force. I'm the pilot of one of those B-17s, one that my crew and I named the Memphis Belle. That's one plane out of 10 in our squadron, out of 40 in our group, out of hundreds in the 8th Air Force. All of us working together to do a job none of us wanted to do. If we're lucky, my crew and I'll finish our part today. We'll be the first crew to finish flying 25 missions over enemy-held Europe. Once we've got 25 under our belts, our tour is over and we can go home. But first, we've got to make it through this mission. It all started at 0800 hours this morning in the briefing room at our base in southern England when Colonel Ray, our group commander, told us today's target. The submarine pens at Wilhelmshaven, Germany. Wilhelmshaven is one of Germany's major ports and is heavily defended by flak and fighters. A tough mission, but that's what we get paid for. Meanwhile, the 3,600 men who keep the fans turning on our group of 40 planes were hard at work doing their jobs. Every one of them is as vital to the successful completion of our mission as any member of the crew. That's us there, getting ready to board our plane. Well, we did. Other members of our squadron were getting their guns out of the armory. or putting on their electrically heated flight suits. Where we're going, we'll need them both. Everything was checked and double-checked before takeoff. In our line of work, there's no margin for error. Even the simplest equipment failure can mean the failure of the mission, or worse. Then it was time. We started up our engines, taxied to our positions, and waited. Finally, the green takeoff flare was fired, and we were off. It took every bit of skill I had to get my 30-ton fortress into the air. And if we suddenly lost an engine, or hit a gust of wind, with a full load of bombs and fuel, we wouldn't have gotten a second chance. Like I said, no margin for error. Once in the air, we joined up in formation and headed for the target. That's me. That's my co-pilot. In civilian life, he's a business administration student at the University of Connecticut. Our radio operator and gunner, a construction worker from Spokane, Washington. Our navigator, he's a chemistry student at Ohio Wesleyan. Our engineer and top turret gunner. He used to be a stevedore in Green Bay, Wisconsin. Now he keeps the bell in order and covers the sky above. That's our tail gunner. He used to clerk for a carpet company in Yonkers, New York, but he quit the day after Pearl Harbor. Our belly turret gunner was a pressman for a rubber company in Rahway, New Jersey. Wouldn't want his job. Sometimes those guys get stuck in that little clamshell of a turret they're sealed into. And if we have a rough landing, well, none of us even want to think about that. We climb past 10,000 feet. The air up here is too thin to breathe, so I tell the crew to put on their oxygen masks. That's our bombardier. Before the war, he operated a fleet of trucks in Fort Worth, Texas. Our right waist gunner, a chemist for a paint company in Chicago. And our left gunner, 19 years old. He used to repair washing machines in Detroit when he was a kid. Now he has two Nazi fighters to his credit. At 300 feet per minute, we climbed toward 25,000 feet, our best operational altitude. That's almost 5 miles straight up, so high you can't be seen with the naked eye. So high that after 1 minute without your supplemental oxygen, you lose consciousness. After 20 minutes, you're dead. From now to the target, we go about our routine duties. Our navigator plots our course while the rest of us check our equipment and wait and think. Higher and colder. Out there is 40 degrees below zero. Lose the electricity in your heated flight suit up here and, well, you get the picture. You look out into the empty sky and wonder if you'll make it back this time. Higher and higher we climb, until the hot exhaust of the engines mixing with the cold, thin air condenses into vapor trails. But to us, they're far from beautiful. They're visible for over 100 miles and point to our formation like giant signposts. And it couldn't happen at a worse time, because at this very moment, we are crossing over the enemy coast into Germany. My co-pilot puts on his flak helmet and we get ready. We watch the skies for enemy fighters. Below us, the enemy tries to conceal the target with a protective smoke screen. And the first bursts of flak appear. This is the worst part of the mission. You can't shoot back at flak. All you can do is fly through it. Within a few minutes, the enemy gunners have the range, and the flak gets really heavy. For the final approach to target, we turn over control of the airplane to the bombardier. He flies the plane through the bomb sight, which is hooked into the plane's autopilot. Evasive action is out of the question. He must fly straight and level to get the most accurate bombing results. As soon as the bombs are away, we do our best to dodge the flak. But no matter what, we have to keep a tight formation. That's our best defense against the enemy's fighters that are sure to jump us now. Individually, we're no match for them. But with our neighbors' guns covering us too, we stand a fighting chance. There. That speck out there is a fighter. That blink is him firing at us. 2,300 rounds per minute. We fire back. At 6 cents per 50 caliber shell, our ammo's cheap. But because of its weight, we only carry 1,000 rounds per gun. That's barely enough for 1 minute of continuous firing. So we act like every round is worth its weight in gold. That's why coordinating efforts between gunners is so important. Without communication and teamwork among the whole crew, we'd soon be overwhelmed and destroyed, even with the support of the rest of the formation. Our airplane's intercom is crucial to this effort. That fortress is hurt. Engine on fire. It's losing airspeed and altitude. In a minute, enemy fighters will be all over it. But all we can do is watch. We can't break formation. Back at our base, the planes with battle damage and wounded aboard get priority in landing. This one has an engine shot out. This one took a direct hit from a burst of flak. Rugged plains, these forts. Rugged men, too. This one made it back entirely on the skill of its crew. The ground crews are there waiting to take the wounded off the planes. Those that are lucky enough to have survived the long trip back. Others aren't so lucky. Still others make it all the way back, only to crash and die within sight of the base. But we in the Memphis Belle have been very lucky. No serious battle damage, no casualties. The last few miles of the mission seem like a joyride. We can finally let go of all the pressure that's built up inside of us over the course of our 25 missions. The feeling is indescribable. Now all that's left is to guide that Belle in for a safe landing. Touchdown. Now the crew and I can do some real celebrating. The rest of the guys on the base seem as happy for us as we are for ourselves. The Belle has done it again. For the 25th time, she's brought all of us home safely. Never be another girl in the world like her. Thanks to her, we can all go home again.
England's pride. the de Havilland Mosquito.
Here's something new, a new pest for the hunt, a pest with plenty of sting and plenty of speed. The mosquito, de Havilland's brilliant newcomer. Unusual in structure, for she's constructed from special woods, therefore lighter than most and very fast. A versatile insect, reconnaissance, bombing, fighting, all come easy to this highly maneuverable aircraft. The bomber, by the way, has a glass nose, that's easy to remember, but this, the fighter version, has a solid nose. From a recognition point of view, she's no pest at all, but is she a pest to the Boche?
That's right. A real pest to the Germans. But to those of us who fly in her, the Mozzie is simply one of the finest combat aircraft ever built. The concept behind the Mosquito is as revolutionary as her performance. The idea is to take an ordinary bomber, strip away all its defensive armament, and all the extra fuel and structure needed to carry them. Build a plane just big enough for a crew of two, a 1,000-pound bomb load and fuel for 1,500 miles, and the result would be a plane 100 miles per hour faster than an ordinary bomber. In fact, with a top speed of 425 miles per hour, she is as fast as any fighter in the air. Remarkable. But even more remarkable is that she is built entirely of wood, so as not to put any strain on the hard-pressed metal industry. A unique construction is used. Birch plywood skin cemented onto spars with a special formaldehyde resin. That's the internal structure of Ecuadorian balsa wood used as bracing between the double layers of birch plywood for the fuselage. The whole thing is fitted together rather like a giant model airplane. Those engines aren't models, though. They're the same 1,250 horsepower Rolls-Royce Merlins that power the Spitfire. And when the whole package is finally assembled, the end result is a beautifully streamlined and deadly fighting machine. A bomber with the speed and maneuverability of a fighter and the versatility to get ready for virtually any type of combat. Combat. That's where I come in. I'm a flight lieutenant in RAF Coastal Command Strike Wing. I have the distinct pleasure of being a navigator in one of those remarkable aircraft. Here, my squadron mates and I receive a briefing on today's mission. A low-level sortie across the North Sea to attack enemy shipping along the German-occupied Norwegian coast. Shipping like this that carries precious iron ore and other minerals from Norwegian mines back to German factories. To increase our fighting effectiveness, our squadron is equipped with three different variants of the Mosquito. The first is the fighter version. Armed with four 20mm cannons and four .303 caliber machine guns, all concentrated in the nose of the ship, she is unsurpassed at strafing ground targets. Here, the sightings of the guns are checked in a test firing. You can imagine what a hail of fire like this would do to a real target. The next version carries a specially adapted quick-firing 57mm field gun that weighs nearly a ton. With the ability to fire a 6-pound shell at a rate of 25 shots in under half a minute, it has a kick like a mule and is deadly to small ships and surfaced submarines. She also carries over half a ton of armor, steel plates up to 3/8 of an inch thick to protect the engines and crew in close battle. The third type carries racks for 8 specially developed aerial rockets. Unlike the 6-pounder gun, there is no recoil problem with rockets, yet they deliver a tremendous punch. A salvo of these is equivalent to the broadside of a cruiser armed with 6-inch guns. Once we're in the air, it's my job to guide us to the target. It's not an easy task. We have almost 400 miles of open sea to cross at virtually wave-top altitude. If I concentrate on my maps and headings, I can keep the formation on course to the target area. But that's not my only responsibility. I also must keep an eye out for enemy fighters. That's one there, an FW-190, racing in on our tail. I tell the pilot to turn away from him and pour on the horsepower. After a few tense minutes, we lose him and continue towards the target. Unlike its larger brethren, the Mosquito doesn't depend on tight formation flying and massed firepower for its defense. Instead, it relies entirely on its speed, and believe me, it has plenty of it. Enough to give the Mozzie the lowest loss rate of any combat aircraft in World War II. Finally, we reach the target area and start a visual search for enemy shipping. And there they are, hiding in that fjord. We dive in immediately for the attack. That way, we give the enemy anti-aircraft gunners less time to react. But they still put up a curtain of defensive fire. We do our best to avoid it as we press in. My job now is to act as an extra pair of eyes for the pilot, looking for targets of opportunity and hotspots of anti-aircraft fire to avoid. There's a salvo of rockets going in. And a hail of 20mm cannon fire raking this enemy ship from stem to stern. Our low-level strafing runs have a devastating effect on the small vessels. The spiky lines in this gun camera footage were caused by the intense cold over the target. The rest of the squadron now goes to work on a group of ships in the next fjord. You can barely make them out as they sweep in to unleash their cannon and rocket fire. Ammunition spent and just enough fuel for the return trip, we form up and head for home. Another successful mission. Just one of the thousands flown by this wooden wonder, the Mosquito. Truly one of the most extraordinary aircraft of all time.
The Boeing B-29 Superfortress.
Early in 1945, our B-29s began full-scale operations against Japan. 1,500 miles to targets, and 1,500 miles back, from bases at Saipan, Tinian, and Guam. Here, 21st Bomber Command concentrated its massive air power and planned the ultimate crushing defeat of Japan, down to the last bomb. Here was the beginning of the end of the road to Tokyo.
Almost overnight, Guam was transformed from an enemy-held bastion into a crowded community of American servicemen. This is where I work. I'm the project officer on the staff of the 21st Bomber Command. That's the boss there smoking the cigar, Major General Curtis LeMay. He's the one that runs the show. He's just gotten a briefing on tomorrow's weather in Japan. He orders us to hit Tokyo with everything we've got, all 600 of our B-29s. Now it's our job to construct a plan and put it into effect. We review the results of hundreds of hours of preparation by the intelligence and operations staffs. These preparations are then assembled into a set of instructions for a raid on the Nakajima Aircraft Engine Factory in suburban Tokyo. It's called Tactical Plan 574. The armament is decided. M-47 incendiary clusters and 1,000-pound general-purpose bombs fused to detonate 1/4 second after impact. All planes will carry capacity fuel loads, 7,300 gallons per plane, and will fly at an indicated airspeed of 210 miles per hour on their bombing runs. A precise location is chosen on the coast of Japan to serve as a radar checkpoint. This will help the formation to find its final approach to the target. The contingency plans for air-sea rescue of downed bomber crews are reviewed. Three surface vessels to be stationed at position X-ray. Four submarines assigned to lifeguard duty at position Yoke. Two Catalina flying boats to orbit at station Zebra. And four B-29s to orbit at these positions to drop survival gear to any crews in the water. Since I have a lot of combat experience as a lead crew pilot, I'm going to tag along on this mission to observe whether the paper plan translates into an effective combat operation. That way we can iron out any operational kinks and improve the planning process in the future. The field order is given, and the 11-man crews of 21st Bomber Command ready their B-29 Super Fortresses for takeoff. Waiting on the runway for the go-ahead to take off is part of the pre-flight ritual of any bomber mission, no matter what kind of plane you fly. The takeoff itself is difficult on the island's short runway. Any help we can receive to get us into the air safely is gratefully accepted. But the best method is still to put on full power, pull back gently on the controls, and use every inch of runway there is. This time we make it without belly flopping into the ocean. Unlike earlier bombers, the fuselage of the Super Fortress is pressurized, so we don't need to wear bulky heated flight suits and cumbersome oxygen masks. I confer with the navigator while he logs the island checkpoints we pass along our route. Pagan, Assumption, and others pass by until finally we reach Iwo Jima, halfway point to Tokyo. It's here that we pick up our fighter escort of P-51 Mustangs, the only fighter in the world with the range to escort us all the way from Iwo to Tokyo and back. They've been well briefed on their part of Plan 574. Warming up into groups over Iwo, they're led to their assembly point by B-29s specially designated as navigator ships. Reports to the controller back at Guam give their flight position. In the operations room, the development of the mission is closely monitored on the situation map. Mount Fuji, symbol of Japan. But this time for us, it's more than that. It also marks the point 60 miles from Tokyo, where we begin our final approach to the target. The pilot informs the crew to get their guns ready. The central fire control system is switched on. This system aids in coordinating the defensive fire of our 12 50 caliber machine guns. Unlike the B-17, all our guns are fired by remote control from sighting stations like these. We're getting close now, so we get our oxygen masks ready in case battle damage causes a sudden cabin depressurization. Flak bursts around us as we level off at our bombing altitude of 12,000 feet. Then come the enemy fighters diving head-on into our formation. Some are suicide planes trying to ram our bombers. Others drop phosphorus bombs in an attempt to break up our formation. Our fighter escort tears in after them. Their tactics are simple. Close in for the kill and destroy the enemy any way they can. furious dogfight, they drive the Japanese fighters away. Now it's up to the bombardier to line us up over the target. The general purpose bombs drop first to pulverize the target. Then come the smaller incendiary clusters to start fires in the heaps of debris. This shot tells you just how far ahead we have to release our bombs to get them to hit the target from our altitude. See why high altitude bombing requires both skill and luck for good results. While the bomber formations head for home, the fighter escorts are released to go down on the deck and use their remaining ammunition to shoot up targets of opportunity. Trains. Factories, airfields, shipping, anything and everything of military value is open for attack. With all their ammo exhausted, the Mustangs form up and head back for Iwo. Back on Guam, they're following our progress every step of the way. There's Mount Suribachi there on the right. That means we've reached Iwo Jima. Now down to their last few gallons of fuel, the fighters arrive back at their base. Iwo wasn't captured at such a high cost just to serve as a base for fighters. It's also a safe haven for wounded B-29s, like this one, which limps in with an engine shot out. And this one, that ditches rather than risking a crash landing with its landing gear jammed in the up position. Finally, the rest of the formation nears the end of our 3,000-mile journey. I go over a few details with the pilot while the rest of the crew gets some well-deserved rest. But everyone is on their toes when Guam comes into sight and we begin our approach to land. Believe me, the runway looks a lot longer when you're landing an empty B-29 than it does when you're taking off in a full one. But each and every one of us knows that we have many more takeoffs and landings left, not to mention bombing runs and battles with enemy flak and fighters. Tactical Plan 574 is a success, but it'll take the successful completion of scores more missions just like it before all of us can really go home.
America's all-purpose bomber, the B-52.
The B-52 Stratofortress. Length, over 150 feet. Wingspan, almost 200 feet. A huge, angular, threatening 8-engine bird of prey. Affectionately known as Buff to those of us who've flown her, these big, ugly, fat fellows have been in service for almost 40 years now. That means there are young pilots flying them today whose fathers did the same thing almost a generation ago. But through constant improvement and upgrading, especially to the plane's avionics, the B-52 remarkably remains on the front line of America's nuclear-armed strategic deterrent. ready to respond to any attack at virtually a moment's notice. These men take their jobs very seriously. Though they're only practicing, they know what a huge responsibility rests on their shoulders. It's not easy to sleep sometimes when you know you can deliver in a single plane load more destructive force than was carried by all the bombers in all the wars that have ever been fought. I should know. I used to be one of those men. In my younger days, I flew a buff for a living. Now I fly a desk at the Pentagon. But I still remember the hair-trigger edginess of being on 24-hour alert, and the gut-tightening feeling of never knowing whether the next alarm meant just another practice run or the beginning of World War III.
Doors open at 10 seconds. FCI pilot.
FCI center. How's it looking visually, Bill?
Looks good, pilot. 10 seconds, doors.
9, 8, 7, 6, 4, 3, 2, 1. Bombs going off.
However, the versatile B-52 hasn't always been part of our nuclear defense forces. There was a time when it carried conventional high-explosive bombs. Bombs like these being readied for loading by ground crews at Anderson Air Force Base on Guam. Ironically, the very same base that served as the headquarters of our B-29 offensive against Japan in World War II was also the starting point of this country's massive bombing attacks against Hanoi in the closing weeks of the Vietnam War. The operation was called Linebacker 2, and it's where I got my first operational experience in buffs. The year was 1972, and I was fresh out of flight school. I was the right seat guy in my crew, the co-pilot. Besides myself, there was the pilot, navigator, radar navigator, electronic warfare officer, and the rear gunner. I had been trained to fly low-level penetration strikes against simulated Soviet targets, so I had no idea what to expect from this type of combat. Of course, I'd read all the accounts of our high-altitude bombing campaigns in World War II, but those were in the days of conventional flak and fighters. We would be flying too high to be bothered by flak, and the enemy would probably keep their fighters away so as not to confuse the radar guidance of their anti-aircraft missiles. More commonly known as surface-to-air missiles, or SAMs, these missiles were the big difference between World War II and Nam, and the big question mark. No bomber force had ever faced a coordinated defensive screen of SAMs before. And by this time, Hanoi had become the most heavily defended target against air attacks in history. That meant lots of SAMs, the densest concentration at any single location on Earth. Just like in the movie 12 O'Clock High, everyone on the base who could came out to the tarmac to watch us take off. In this shot, you can see the external rack of 24 750-pound bombs we carried to complement the 84 500-pound bombs loaded in our bomb bays. The total was a staggering 60,000 pounds. That's the equivalent bomb load of 15 fully loaded B-17s. It's a wonder we were even able to get off the ground. Once in the air, we rechecked our systems and formed up with the other two planes in our cell. We flew in groups of three to allow us the maximum coverage for our electronic countermeasures against SAMs. The days when bombers depended on the concentrated firepower of massive formations for their defense was long gone. Machine guns were no use against radar-guided missiles. Neither were fighter escorts. When we reached altitude, our next objective was to rendezvous with our aerial tanker. That's another thing that had changed since World War II. With aerial refueling, we had virtually unlimited range. We proved it once by flying a formation of buffs around the world non-stop. That's it there, the KC-135 tanker. Our navigator got us within visual range, then we did the rest. We descended below the tanker, and then began a gentle climb to close into refueling position. Mid-air refueling is a job that takes a great deal of experience and skill to master. Both the pilot and the boom operator on the tanker have to be proficient and cool. Our pilot, had to get our plane close to the tanker and hold it steady. Then the boom operator had to literally fly the boom into our refueling receptacle, which is just aft of the cockpit. Wasn't easy. Putting two big aircraft fully loaded with gas and bombs so close together at such a high speed was a delicate and dangerous operation under the best of circumstances. Add some turbulence to the equation, and you could end up with big trouble real fast. On that first mission, it took more than one try to get us linked up. Finally made the hookup and began taking on fuel. The pit stop lasted about 25 minutes, during which we took on over 100,000 pounds of gas. When we finally disconnected, the pilot was drenched with sweat from the intense physical and mental concentration it took to complete the maneuver. The rest of the trip over the pond was relaxed. I remember the rear gunner even bragging about the MiG he was going to shoot down. But over in Hanoi, the North Vietnamese were anything but relaxed. Even as we approached, they were bolstering their defenses. Here, truckloads of Soviet-supplied SA-2 anti-aircraft missiles are being delivered to one of the four SAM sites in downtown Hanoi. But I couldn't worry about that just yet. As the co-pilot of the lead ship in our cell, my primary jobs during the bomb run were handling communications between our plane and the others and keeping the heading marker updated to the bomb run heading so the pilot would have a reference mark to return to after evasive maneuvers. Only then was I supposed to watch for SAMs. I didn't have to wait long. I saw the first one ignite on its launcher and streak toward us like a Roman candle. Then another. And another. There were seven altogether. Four on our inbound run and three over the city. Thanks to our evasive action and electronic jamming, only one came close. But two other planes on our mission weren't so lucky. I'll never forget the sound of the beepers going off in my headset. Those are the emergency radio locator beacons that are automatically activated after a crewman ejects. There were a lot of them that day. Despite our losses, we hit the target hard. The return trip to Guam was a lot more subdued and introspective than the trip over. As we were landing, I couldn't help thinking about all the other crewmen who flew in all the other bombers throughout history. Did they feel as emotionally drained and physically exhausted as I did when they came back after their first mission? As much as things had changed in the many years since the first bombing mission was flown, somehow, I think they did.
Things have changed since that first bombing mission. Planes like the B-2 Stealth exemplify many of the revolutionary changes that have transformed the bomber into something that would be practically unrecognizable to the bomber crews of the past. But one thing that hasn't changed is the fact that it's the men who fly them who are the key element in the success or failure of the bomber aircraft.
Bomber crewmen have described their trade as hours and hours of pure boredom interspersed with moments of sheer terror. But the men who fly these great aircraft believe in their mission and are willing to face those moments of terror. Technological advances have reduced the size of the crew and made the aircraft more effective, but teamwork still remains the most important part of success. And even though its role has shifted from one of massed raids on the enemy to one of deterrence, the bomber still endures as a cornerstone of our national defense, and so it will remain well into the distant future.
Thank you. seven, six, up, four, three, two, one. I'm going on.